I'm Gerard Scarpacey here, craft hairdresser and co-founder of the Hairbrain Community. Super excited to be with my buddy Travis Barker. We're in his awesome studio. I'm definitely going to turn the camera around so you can see how cool and unique this is. He's going to be sharing with you on this lovely Pivot Point mannequin, one of our Professionals Who Practice series. And the whole idea behind this is that even when you're experienced or old dudes like me and Travis, right. We were just talking, we've been doing this now for close to 30 years and been in the education game for a while, it's still so important, no matter how experienced you are, to keep trying out new ideas and getting your hands on great mannequins so that you can practice without having to worry about anything. That's one of the great things about a mannequin. So Travis is going to get into his lesson today. He's got a great lesson. He's got visuals. He's got pre-done mannequins. He's got it all. I'm going to jump behind the camera, and I'm going to be filming and looking for your questions. So share the love, share the questions, and I'll make sure that we get great angles of Travis's haircut. So Travis, take it away.
Thank you, brother. Welcome, everybody. Super hyped to have this opportunity to work with Pivot Point and Hairbrained to build this really cool haircut for you guys today. We're seeing tons of shags in general right now. How do we create them? And not every single shag is created exactly the same way. So I'm excited to bring this one to you today on this amazing mannequin from Pivot Point. One of our favorites, one that we actually built with L'Oreal Professionnel. We were very particular on hair cam on the mannequins and how they were sewn, even down to really understanding where the cowlick lives on the head and how that can change from person to person to person. So when creating our profile section and our radials and simply creating our quadrants, are we building an off natural fall to the cowlick or are we not? So really cool that they think that extra much about the details that make our mannequins that much more realistic. So super excited. Stay tuned, guys. More to come.
Awesome. As you get started, I'm going to share some love. You got a lot of friends tuning in. Our buddy Sid Sotong over in the UK. He's a great friend. Samantha Jones is here. Maria Braden says, so excited for this. Thank you. Our buddy Ben Brown, who was featured on a Hairbrain Live a few weeks ago and killed it.
What's up?
He's sending some love.
Thank you.
And I know your buddy Jeremy Taylor is on here, Mad Love Homie. I know Jeremy works with you here in your academy.
One of our educators at the Travis Barker Academy.
Awesome. Okay, so again, guys, let us know where you're watching from. Share your questions here for Travis. He's an awesome educator. I'm going to get in a little bit closer here so that we can see. So, yep, she doesn't mind. She's a mannequin.
All right, guys, so what we're doing right now is we're really just figuring out what's going to live in the length of the haircut. So the total length in the baseline of the haircut, what's going to be inside of that with the layers or graduation, and in this case it will be layers, and what's happening around the face, the three topics that we think about with every single haircut. And so what I will be developing first is a sloping horseshoe pattern that really just separates layers from length. And what we need to make sure that we're doing in this with building convex layers, which will be the layering pattern for our shag, is that we are taking our section below the actual center of the recession area.
All right, so I've heard a couple terms already. A sloping horseshoe, was that the term that you used?
Yes, yeah, so a sloping horseshoe is a horseshoe, traditional horseshoe, that we've created in our curriculum that really just incorporates the side of the head with the top of the head. So as we're working with the vertical elements, the side and the horizontal of the top, we do build this line down below the actual parietal ridge, which integrates the layers from the top of the head into the side of the head in a seamless manner.
So horseshoes are a big part of all hair cutting, separating the top from the bottom, would you say?
Absolutely.
Yeah, probably one of the most popular and salon-friendly kind of sections there is.
Yeah, textbook 101. And just as much as a horseshoe is super important, as I said before, reading the contours of the head becomes a crucial element as well. So when dividing and conquering your actual style between layers and length, where does everything live?
All right, so I'm noticing something that I always do, and I, no matter how many times I say this in class, people don't always hear me. I think getting a horseshoe in is actually kind of difficult. So I do exactly what you do. I make this separation at the from the high point of the head to the back of the ears.
Absolutely.
And it just makes it so much easier to get it in, where I very often I find people chasing it all the way around the head, trying to get it in their hand in one.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, one of the best things about a horseshoe to always discover is from the center of the recession, that usually in a very literal way, horizontally, transfers right through the parietal ridge. So if you're trying to create a traditional horseshoe, as you probably recognize, you're taking it from the center of the recession, through the parietal ridge, through the center of the crown, and then, of course, looping it back and around. What I will do as I'm separating this out, because I've got a little bit more
real estate that's happening in through the back is I'm going to clip the top out of the way. And what I mean by real estate is I'm really encompassing the convex area of the back of the head from the concave area of the back of the head. And once again, we are going to take this now and clip everything back. You may have noticed that we are building this on dry hair. So we are going to be developing a dry cut. One of the elements about this is really understanding the anatomy, as we've talked about quite a bit. But at the same time, this is a shag. It's supposed to have this languid, slept-in sort of feel. So the imperfection is really what gives it the signature. So as much as we're reading the anatomy and respecting it, at the same time, this isn't your time to really get too crazy over the details. What I really want you to do is allow them to just be.
And here's some examples. I know Travis put together a little screen here. So this is kind of the idea of what he's going to be working on, this kind of mid-length, very layered through shag. And you can see the pre-done mannequins here as well. He's gone the extra mile. And here you can see all the sectioning for the haircut, again, on these pre-done pivot point mannequins. So again, if you're wondering what exactly you're going to be learning, I can guarantee you it's worth it because this is such a valuable look. And we're getting that sectioned off right now here. You guys can see how beautiful his space is here in the background. All the beautiful art and furniture. I think it really exemplifies that Travis is a true designer here. I've been in the space now for an hour and it just makes me feel good. And that's what design's all about.
Yeah, everything's about energy. I mean, here we are in a cutting tutorial, but it's all about the flow and the energy. Everything together is what creates the experience. So not just you being a technical hairdresser, but where are you at with interpersonal relationships and also the contextual environment that you surround yourselves in. Every detail has been attended to at the Travis Parker Academy. And so we can focus on the haircutting at hand. All of that just flatters and complements the investment on the technical.
Awesome. So it looks like you've got your basic sectioning in.
I've got my basic sectioning in. We are going to start with building our baseline in the haircut. I'm going to start by standing at 6 o'clock in the back. I'm going to clip that out of the way. And at 6 o'clock, just so we are continuing to reference the same terms, I'm going to call her nose 12 o'clock. Her right ear will be 3 o'clock. 6 will be dead center in the profile of the back, and 9 will be on the right ear. So with that said,
I love that you're using that reference. Do you know our buddy Ira Pope's age?
Yeah.
Have you seen his clock cutting method?
No.
It's pretty awesome. He's got, I'll send you some videos where he's really kind of come up by using those times that you were just saying. He talks completely about everything he's doing in his hair cutting in terms of overdirection, elevation. It's a great, great fun thing. I know you'd love it.
I definitely would love it. And to be honest, it's a huge part of our curriculum and content and the way we think about processing a haircut so we can find symmetry and continuity on both sides. So if we're referencing body positioning, where are you in relation to that section so you can replicate it on both sides?
Yeah, instead of just saying I'm in the back or I'm in the front, if you're using actual time zones. All right, we're going to get in here up close now. We're going to start doing some cutting.
You can see I've got a slight bit of overdirection from my radial. I'm standing in the center of my profile. The center of my body is aligned with the center of the back of the head. I am going to subdivide this with a slight diagonal forward section and drop this back in. I've got loose tension. Fingers, with the help of the mannequin head, are going to be just below. This is going to become my guide to length, just about 1 to 2 inches below the neckline. And what we're going to start with is this shear up on top, and we're just going to slightly slide on top of the hair here to displace some of the weight and start to create the texture that's happening through the back right here. I don't move. My right shoulder and my left shoulder stay square to the actual head shape. I'm developing a square baseline with a very loose edge to it. So just continuing to feather the hair.
So would you say you're getting a tapered effect? It's kind of getting a bit thinner and thinner towards the actual length?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm displacing the weight and removing the length at the same time. And what that does is it helps to build these thinner edges through the perimeter of the actual haircut. So just looking for a serrated edge, but with some consistency to it. Fingers need to stay square to the head. Moving over to the other side now, one of our most challenging things, as much as it's basic, is getting two sides even. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a small piece from the previous side that's just been cut, an area from the hair that hasn't been cut. I'm gonna gather this towards the center, find the center of the back of the head. I'm gonna pull this down, and I'm gonna point cut a contact point onto the second side here, Once again, making sure that's centered.
So it's giving you both corners.
Yeah, so now I just have to connect the dots. So if you're anything like me, you've probably cut hair crooked before. So for me, instead of checking whether my hair was symmetrical or not at the end of a haircut, I thought of an idea like this to help me with the beginning of the haircut.
Now, especially when everything is so freeform, it can be kind of easy for the balance to get away from you, can it?
Absolutely. Well, and back to body positioning, again, if I'm not totally centered with the body, then I've always got this to connect with. So again, if I sort of fall off the rails a little bit, I've got that as a safety net. And it's just giving me a little bit more security as I move forward. And again, as I remove length.
So again, if you're just joining us, Gerard Scarpacy here behind the camera today with Travis Parker in his Travis Parker Academy, which you can kind of see in the background. Kind of a beautiful little atelier. I'm going to give a little 360 around here. You can see how awesome it is. And you can also see that Travis has pre-done a few mannequins for us so we can get an idea of what the look is. He's got some head sheets here up on the screen that we'll be able to go over. So you guys are getting a great lesson today from a very, very experienced educator, which is fantastic. Looks like you're moving into the sides, Travis.
Yeah.
So let's talk about how we make that transition.
Absolutely. Using the fine teeth of my comb, but barely any tension, I'm coming through the sides here. You can do a slight tap above and below the ear just to elevate that section a little bit more so you don't overcut it. And we're going to pull that back down again, see where that layer lives. We're developing a square baseline, so I've got a corner right behind the back of the head here. And leaving that corner in just develops a little bit more weight back in through here, so I'll see that carried length around the front of the shoulders.
I want to give a few shout-outs to some of our local friends watching. Chris Ray is watching.
Okay.
Says West Coast Edition. Heck yeah, he's excited to see Travis. Our buddy Michael Snyder is watching. He's always tuning in. And he's got a great question. He'd like to know, who was your mentor, Travis?
Oh my gosh, I've had so many mentors. I would say my greatest mentor is probably Andrew Barfield. He was the VP of Education of L'Oreal. And that guy helped me really get out of my head, probably more than anything. And that was the biggest inhibiting factor, I'd say, with really just letting go. Andrew was massive for me. There was a gentleman named Roger Tuttle that came into my life when I was 18 and really set me off to the right start as well, building a foundation to the way I thought about cutting. I have now, as Gerard's spinning 360 degrees around the room, I'm using the disc from my pivot point mannequin, and I'm taking that, and so I don't have to actually move. I can actually just switch the mannequin around by pivoting back and forth.
Yeah, that was a tripod that Pivot Point designed with educators in mind, so you'd be able to move the head around and show different angles, so it's great to see you're using it.
Oh my gosh, for stage performance or if I've got an audience right in front of me, it becomes clutch. Matter of fact, I use it constantly.
So what are you thinking about here with this? Would you call what you're doing there slicing? That's kind of the name that I typically use. Do you have a different language for it or?
No, I would say that's exactly the same thing. I'm slicing from the inside out
and then point cutting,
yeah.
Any particular tips on either one of those techniques?
Yeah, I would say when I'm cutting from the inside out, what I'm looking at is density as well. So when I've got thicker areas in this little channel you can see running through here, I may feather up just a little bit higher to displace more weight, not closing the shears as much. So I'm not removing the length as much. But at the same time, I'm trying to marry the densities in together so the reed is the same. And I see the same texture and movement continuously on both sides. When I rifle through cutting through the bottom with point cutting, what I'm really looking to do is either parallel point cut, so I'm directly cutting into the tip of the hair, or if I come at an angle, I just have to make sure I come back the opposite direction as well, so the hair swings both directions.
So even when you're working so freehand, I think is, you know, the accepted term, or visually, mm-hmm. balance and technique is still super important.
Absolutely. I mean, I need to have structure inside of this haircut in order for it to be sustainable. So my haircut doesn't look great if my haircut doesn't look great when she leaves, that's probably more about my ego and probably more about my fabrication of the cut and the actual style. But when my client comes back, how good does her hair look, say, 8 weeks later, 12 weeks later? It's these fundamental things and these practices that I build into the nature of the way I build haircuts that help to find sustainability or create sustainability in the actual looks.
Got a great question coming in from Lara Clark that I think a lot of people wonder about or ask about when it comes to dry cutting. Hey there, if you were working with thick, wavy, curly hair, would you straighten the hair before cutting, or would you approach the cut completely differently? Many thanks from Lara Clark.
Gosh, many thanks. There's so many answers in that. A lot of it depends on, I would say, my first question, and that's, you know, how often does a client wear hair with natural texture versus fabricating the actual texture with a flat iron, a brush, or curling iron? If she builds her style and fabricates it, it doesn't really matter what her natural texture is. You can sort of disrespect it because it's always being created and fabricated. If she wears her natural texture, I would absolutely build it off of that. Matter of fact, I would probably start the construction of the cut on the hair when the hair was wet versus dry. And then I would dry the hair. And if my ideologies were in place and everything worked out, I would probably see an end result that was probably concrete. I might have a little bit of detail. If not, then what I need to do is come in and at that point, rebuild things based upon what the natural curls are actually doing. So continuing to slice through the hair, you can see I was doing a little twist left and right. We're going to be doing more of that in the front of the hair. And that twist cut technique just continues to thin the hair out as I move more towards the ends. Now, this is my layering pattern. I've clipped everything underneath my layering out of the way, but I brought the layering down to the baseline. The baseline itself will dictate the length that I use as a guide to length from there on up. What we are going to do is we're going to take this entire section using the large teeth of the comb, and I'm going to comb it straight out from the section, top to bottom. I'm going to find a 90 degree curvature in between the two points, and that becomes the degree of elevation. Once I get that, I'm going to comb that straight out, finding my guide to length, which is below my finger there. I'm going to lift my hand and then fold it back over, and I'm going to deep point cut into the ends here.
So can we talk about deep point cutting? I mean, number one, obviously, I think sometimes people can get a little bit scared about cutting themselves. So any tips there
can stock help. Up on Band-Aids.
Yeah.
I would say you just want enough hair to travel out from the hand, so you've got plenty of distance there to allow the tip of the shear to move through the entirety of the section.
And I see you're very deliberate about it. You're not just whacking away at it. I think sometimes that's what happens is we go into like lawnmower mode. Instead of like thinking, it seems like you're really calculating every snip.
Yeah, and it's a fair point, and thank you for identifying that. It's very methodical. What I don't want to do is just get in there and create drama and theatrics in general. What I'm trying to build is sustainability in the cut. And respecting the contours of the head and the integrity of the hair, I've got to come in a very calm state. So just finding my breath, aligning myself again, I'm going to cut from the inside out in this case.
What is there a difference between inside out versus outside in? Does it change the way the hair falls in some way?
Well, in general, it's another ballot question. In general, when we're cutting from the inside out, we're usually displacing more weight and respecting the length. In this case, I've actually got my shear at an angle, so I'm removing length at the same time. And then I'll come back in and deep point cut. But the contrast is, again, usually when we're coming from the inside out, we're respecting the cut line itself and just displacing weight through the edge of the hair. At the same time, when we're coming from the outside in, we're usually removing length and weight at the same time. So it depends upon where you're going. The reason I sliced from the inside out in this case was that I had all this additional hair here. And instead of rough cutting that off, I just spliced through it to get rid of it. So that
now,
was my approach.
Continuing on this theme, does the type of scissor you're using, you know, with this type of freehand cutting make a big difference?
Yeah, I would say, you know, and everybody probably has their own personal feel as tools are unique to each one of us. But I'm using an all-purpose shear. This is a 6.2 Mizutani. And what I love about this is it's dry and wet cut. So the hair doesn't fold in between the blades, whether it's wet or dry.
Mizutani make great scissors. If you guys are interested in trying them out, we have some available on hairbrain.pro. Some of the favorite ones that we've pre-selected there.
What I am doing as I move through section by section is I'm following the previous section as a guide to length. I am taking slight diagonal forwards, which I'll show you again, slight diagonal forwards, that's just moving from the profile section by section by section as I'm rotating around the head. Every section is on base at this point, using again the previous as a guide to length, and going 90 from the center changes section by section as the contour of the head changes as I move more towards the recession behind the back of the ear.
Well, what are some of the things people can do to kind of get more familiar with head shape? I think as I've taught lots of people over the years and they start to understand the expanded form of the haircut, sometimes they have a harder time judging head shapes. Is there Anything that you do, any way to read the head? I see you're really focused on where you're combing from. Any tips there?
Yeah, I would say everything starts with understanding the first section that you're going to be building the haircut from. And so when I first start with my profile, which splits the left side from the right side, and my radial, which dissects the front from the back, what I'm starting to do is really map the head. The next thing I'm thinking about is in the back. The top of the head is convex. Underneath area is concave. So what's going to live in negative space versus positive space? If I'm building something above something that's protruding in its way, it's got to be thought of in a different sense. So right out of the gate, just setting myself up to succeed, what I have to do is map the head with quadrants and then again build my main sectioning pattern in place so I really understand where the layers are going to live in difference from the length.
All right, so you're starting now on the second side. For those who maybe missed the first side, just recap this whole layering technique for us.
Absolutely. We took a profile section in the very beginning. That profile section's length was dictated from the baseline itself. The baseline dictated the length here. We cut that in. We elevated that up, taking everything at a 90-degree angle from the center of the section that I'm currently working in. We are going to start with slicing from the inside out.
And if you could almost do that in slow motion, absolutely, so people could really, sometimes I think that really helps to understand the action of slicing from the inside out.
100%.
Let's really see the mechanics here.
I am just backing up a little bit, guys. I took a section that was too far forward to the right-hand side, and I couldn't find my guide. And what I was trying to look at was little tiny hairs versus a cut line. So I just am backing up a little bit, which will allow me to proceed with confidence, finding my 90, and once I've got that 90 in there, again, the teeth, as you can see, bridge of the comb against the head, teeth dictate that 90, aligning the fibers of the hair with the actual teeth, pulling that straight out. There's my guide to length inside. So I'm going to come over to the side so we can see it better, and cutting from the inside out, just displacing.
And it seems like the scissor is more, I want to say, perpendicular to your finger there.
Absolutely. Yeah. If I come in sideways like this, flat to my hand, I can start notching out that whole area there. So I'm going to get more divots inside of it, which is, if that's your intention, that's fine. Just make sure that you're doing it with intention. Cause and effect, something's happening. Is it lending to the end result?
And now point cutting. So working, it's almost like there's layers within the ends of the hair, and then you come back in and take the length off.
Absolutely. Yeah, refining that line. The first one really is about excavating the hair and displacing that weight at the same time and really rough cutting that line. Point cutting comes in and allows me to really build the line with structure in it. And then what I'm doing is coming back through it one last time per section here and just finding again the denser areas. We can see that this area right here is quite a bit thicker than the area underneath it. So at that point, because the ends, when we cut from the inside out, we're not removing length, I'm just displacing that much more thickness in there.
We've got our great friends and family watching from all over the world. Our friend Stephen Fite, an old friend who's very much a craft hairdresser, watching.
Nice.
We've got Junior Mondrial watching, I'm assuming from Hawaii, because he's saying aloha.
Yeah, I wish I was in Hawaii.
Yeah.
Right now, brother.
Charlotte Newell is watching. She says hi.
Our
friend and someone who's been featured on quite a few Hairbrain Lives, Milo Maksimovic, who was just in Poland for us doing a Hairbrain Live. He says, great way of thinking. He likes the way you're thinking.
Thank you, sir. We've got
a question coming in from Victoria Arzola. If you were cutting this on naturally curly hair and point cutting, would you tend to over-direct the curl pattern a bit more?
It depends. What we have to think about is, what does over-direction create? The further any hair travels from its natural section to another section, we're going to obtain length. So if you want more length somewhere within the haircut, whether it's around the face and you want more additional length in through here or in through the back, over-directed forward or back just maintains that additional length. So based upon your objective and the overall silhouette, just depends. If you're trying to do this exact same haircut on somebody with curly hair, I would follow the same sectioning pattern that I am. And everything behind the radial right now is on base as we move behind the radial.
So it's really a choice about how much weight you want to distribute, than anything.
I think that we could probably all
how much length and weight.
Yeah. Yeah, length and weight, that no one's hair is really exactly the same. And what we have to do is really generalize and categorize types of hair so that we can read it and position it. But at the end of the day, what creates your artistry and the signature of your cut on anybody is these decisions that you make yourself. But like every decision, you want to come from a grounded point of experience and expectation so that you can find certainty in these decisions as you're creating them.
Nicole Braden Baza, hopefully I'm pronouncing that correctly, Nicole. She just booked course 1 and 2 with you, Travis. And
no
she
way!
Yeah.
How rad is that?
So as you're working on the technique here, can you talk a little bit about your academy? I'm going to just do a quick 360 so people can see we're down here in the northern part of San Diego. Beautiful, beautiful area. And the Travis Parker Academy, which is this really beautiful, intimate studio. And Travis works on his private clientele here, but then also is offering courses. And I know he's got a lot of education coming out right now. So fill us in a little bit on that.
First of all, thank you again for booking the class. Second of all, thank you for asking about it. Third, I've never been part of something I'm so excited about right now. And what we're really doing is we built a methodology on how I feel that we should learn how to cut hair. And what I've taken is my 32 years of experience of cutting hair behind the chair and really started to look into what worked for me and what didn't work for me. The other thing that I've really thought about with developing our curriculum is where and how are we receiving content right now? How is the information that we're digesting being received? And so when we started fabricating the curriculum, we really wanted to build it for the mindset of how, again, we live life today. So it's a revisit to how we learn how to cut hair, how we execute the process. And what we've really built into this is no DNA of our own, just real structural, straightforward executables that allow you to build your vision. And that's where we're at. That's where we were really at. We decided that a lot of us are starting to have a voice on Instagram, but as I just lost mine a second ago, when we do speak about hairdressing, do we speak a continuous language that other people understand? Do we speak a language that allows us to really communicate in a direct way? And when it came down to it, I thought that we could do it in a way that would make it that much more native for our audience. So we've created 3 different pillars. It starts with cutting course 1, goes to cutting course 2, and cutting course 3. And like most basic fundamental curriculums, cutting course 1 really helps you understand baseline from layers and layers from face framing. Within that, we have broken it down so that you are really learning how to build shapes and silhouettes in the first course. In the second course, it really takes you into texturizing and personalization, where we integrate all kinds of inside-out cutting and outside-in cutting. And in the third course, we really start to break all those rules, combine different things together, and start to build it in a way that allows you to make the decisions, not us dictating the instruction itself. I am in front of the radial now, so just catching you guys up. I've taken diagonal forward sections, which just allows each section to lie on top of the other, so we don't really see the seams that we're creating inside the haircut. As I've approached the area in front of the radial, forgive me, I'm taking the area behind the radial to act as a guide to length. Next section is going to be a diagonal forward, and I'm going to continue to take this back to the section just behind the back of the radial again. I've got the head leaning to the opposite direction that I'm actually cutting on.
Let's step back so we can see that. So that's deliberate.
That's deliberate, yeah. And what this is doing is it's allowing me to really focus on my elevation. My elevation in this case changes in front of the radial, and my elevation now is coming up the parietal ridge. When I lean her over to the side here, I can see the parietal ridge that much more. It's not vertical. And so with that said, I find that I have a tendency to keep my layers true if I lean her over to the side. And I'll do the same thing on the opposite side. Bringing it straight out from the head, finding that cut line, and we're going to deep point cut into that.
Okay, a great question coming in from Charlotte Newell. What advice do you have for someone just starting their cosmetology career? I know that's a big one, Travis, but with your 32 years of experience, what advice do you have for someone just starting their cosmetology career?
Don't have a goal of what you're supposed to be. Have ambition of where you want to be. Allow that to drive you and allow yourself to make mistakes. It's going to become your greatest strengths, those mistakes you make. What we have to think about is every strength has an attached weakness to it and vice versa. So we can use these weaknesses when we're first learning to really build our expertise and our level of comprehensive understanding of something. But I ask you, don't race to the finish line. Allow yourself to mature through the process. Allow chapters to build your story. And allow mistakes to happen, because those become your opportunities to really become an expert upon that specific subject. So for what that's worth, I hope that helps.
Yeah, I love the part about, you know, allowing the mistakes to happen. And, you know, I one bit of practical advice I'll give Charlotte is, you know, practicing on great mannequins. I know we're doing this here for Pivot Point. Obviously, they're a supporter brand of Harebrain. But the truth is, the reason why we do it is that we truly believe that technically it's better to try. If you've never done this technique before that Travis is sharing, you should definitely try it out on a mannequin and see how the effect is.
Well, and as a personal testimonial to Pivot Point, I've been using Pivot Point mannequins forever, well before I was ever networked with a group for this opportunity. This came long after my relationship of just loving their mannequins. So,
well, yeah, it's absolutely true.
One had nothing to do with the other at all.
I mean, that's why it was so easy for us to have this relationship, because being educators and working with educators, it's definitely the brand that top educators will always work with for mannequins. And what I always like to mention at that point as well is that what a lot of people don't know about Pivot Point is that they are an SA8000 corporation. And what that means is where they source, where they manufacture all around the world, they stick to the highest standards and ethics. They pay a fair living wage, and all their employees are treated with the best respect. And I think that's important as well to take it to that next level. All right, let's get back into this layering technique here. We've been jiving for a while. So again, for everyone that's just joining us, we're here at the Travis Parker Academy, and Travis is sharing a shag technique, a layered shag. So that's a beautiful way of layering the hair there. Let's break that down.
Absolutely. So we've created a square baseline to start the cutoff. We built it by slicing from the inside out so we could develop a little bit of a narrowed perimeter line as we built that in. We started off with convex layering in the back, which is basically hugging our layers into a shorter area around the parietal ridge. From the back, we kept everything on base, and we took everything 90 off the curvature of the section that we were working in. From the radial forward, I'm going to take the previous cut section to act as a guide to length behind the back of the radial. I'm going to ask my client to lean slightly over to the side that I'm not working on, which allows me to find the parietal ridge with that much more clarity. And from the radial forward, we're going 90 off the parietal in this case. And as you can see, I'm going to find my 90. The teeth dictate the elevation of the section, which is a huge help.
So meaning when you put the spine on the head like that, you look at the angle of the teeth.
Yeah, so I'm rocking back and forth to find the apex.
The apex
is the parietal ridge. The bridge of the comb is on the apex. The teeth are dictating 90 off that apex, in this case, the parietal ridge. I align the hair so the fibers are in the same sort of place, or same place exactly. I can bring the teeth in and comb that straight back out.
I like that one. Thank you. I've never quite explained it that way before, so I'll be
really?
Stealing that.
Yeah, no, yeah I'll be stealing away. That. It's all just part back to strengths and weaknesses. All of this stuff comes from us messing up and finding these little tactical ways that help us to navigate success, predictability.
And again, still working with no overdirection, as you're saying, on base or?
Right now, this is slightly overdirected back to the radial.
So once you kind of start to get into the sides, there's a bit of overdirection.
Yeah, a bit of overdirection. And what I want to do is I want to leave additional real estate and weight around the face. So as I build her fringe, I've got more to work with than probably what I need, but sort of a safety net. Next section, I'm going to take this right at the parietal now. That will become stationary. And continue with my diagonal forward lines.
Now, what's your thought on the size and thickness of the sections and how it affects what you're doing?
That's a great call. Yeah, it's what we have to understand is that if you're pinching too much hair in your hand, you might be traveling, your sections might be traveling too much. You're going to get undulations between your sections if you pull things too far from both directions.
I used to call them moguls.
Yeah, it's totally moguls. I used to call them moguls when I used to race BMX. Jumping moguls. Yeah. So yeah, same.
Literally, you're condensing too much of the head shape, so you're over-directing too much and you get like this dip.
Right.
So therefore, you believe the section should be about how thick?
I'm taking sections based upon the density read of this specific mannequin with about half an inch to 3/4 inch in width of sections. Now, as I'm over directing this back to a stationary point behind the radial, clearly my sections are becoming thicker and thicker. But the hair that I'm actually cutting off at the cut line, it itself, is just the thin new layer that I'm constantly bringing in to the stationary point. And deep point cutting again, getting through any of those loose little edges there.
So really from the beginning of the haircut, everything has been about kind of using that slicing first to remove the bulk and the weight, get the taper established, and then using pointing to define the texture at the ends of the hair.
Yeah, I mean, it's with all due respect to all the techniques that are out there, this is one additional technique that we can use to create this type of an effect. It doesn't necessarily have to be done this way. A lot of cuts like this I've been doing lately with my razor, and I couldn't love any tool more, and I know that you're a huge razor guy.
So, I certainly am.
I mean, I couldn't love digging into this anymore with a razor, but at the same time, here we were with a Facebook Live. We had X amount of time to execute the actual cut live, and so what was going to be the best approach for me to drive the most intent behind this video that I could? And it's no different. The reason I'm outframing this right now is it's no different to the client in your chair. You have to make the decision on the fly. And if you've only got one technique to use, it may not apply to all. So this is one that we're using today, which hopefully will help.
I like that. It's kind of what great work in the salon is about, is being able to make really great choices.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So having practiced, trial and error, had your mannequins lined up and thought about all the different techniques and see how they respond, you know, because I've never been brave enough to just make like guesses on a client. I like to have really informed choices.
Well, I mean, In essence, isn't that why we use our mannequins, right?
That's exactly right.
And, fall here instead of with a real person. I'd much rather practice a couple times, if not 20 million times on a mannequin before I apply it to the real person. What you can't see back over there is my storage area of all these mannequins. And we probably have about 100 mannequins in there that have been pre-cut, that have led us to all the understandings that we have about the technical approach to haircutting, period. We've finished the baseline. We did a square baseline through the bottom. We cut from the inside out. We finished our layers. We were developing convex layers throughout our haircut. Everything behind the radial that lives in the back of the head was stationary. As we moved through everything in front of the radial to the front of the head, everything was over-directed to the back of the head. Now that I've got that in place, what I would like to do is blend my layers and length together and make sure that everything is playfully, you know, sharing the same head together and giving me the shape that I'm actually looking for. So I am going to pivot the head to the left here. I'm going to ask my client to lean slightly forward. I'm going to come into the back here. I'm going to, with my fingers, derive a profile section just real loose. And in between where my sloping horseshoe was and the length of the neck, I just want to make sure that all those lines blend together. So deep point cut in through here, real loose through that line there. What doesn't get cut is just as important as what does, but I still, again, want a little bit of blend. This is all going pretty well right here, so not much in there. Last section behind the recession on the right hand side here, or last section behind the recession on the right side, I'm going to continue just to build the blend of those lines, and so far everything's going pretty well. So as we move in front of the radial, we're going to see probably a little bit more disconnection, so I'm excited to share with you right now how I would approach that.
I want to give a few shout outs. Camilla Elwert Bamka says, beautiful studio.
Thank you.
Victoria Arzola, who asked a great question before, says, thank you so much. I love watching your technique. Charlotte Newell, who asked the question about being in cosmetology school, she wants to thank you for your advice.
Absolutely.
And Rita Rivera is here, and she says, hi. So, guys, we're here with Travis Parker, the Travis Parker Academy in northern San Diego. Beautiful, beautiful place. We're just stone's throw from the beach here, and also quite a trendy little strip here. When I pulled into where the salon is, lots of great little stores that I might be stopping at before I head out. And then Travis has this incredible Travis Parker Academy's private studio where he works on his clients. Great taste in furniture here. We were discussing, I think, what people tend to call Hollywood Regency.
Dude, I can't wait to see your place.
Yeah, Definitely. You'll have to come up for a barbecue.
For sure.
And, you know, I want to point out again, and maybe we'll take 1 second here to talk about the head sheets.
Yeah, of course.
The diagrams. So for those of you who've been watching, if you need a little bit of a clear clarification, you can see Travis made these great diagrams, and they go with his pre-done mannequins. So this was the sectioning, the sloping horseshoe separated from the bottom. These are some examples of the finished look here with a little bit of different styling. And then here's the sectioning. You can see started in the back, pivoted around the crown, came into the sides. You can see the elevation here. And I have a feeling pretty soon we're going to be getting to this face frame. So here's a little preview of what's going to happen in the front. All right, let's get back to the live haircut.
You guys, if you didn't already, maybe let's have Gerard go back and see the full screen of that TV and screenshot the phone right now so you've got the diagrams to replicate this haircut.
Great idea. Here you
so
go.
Instead of just taking it in.
Ready, everyone? Screenshot now. 1, 2, 3, screenshot.
I like it.
Okay, awesome.
It's kind of funny.
Yeah, we're interactive here. We're engaging with the audience.
All right, guys, so just continuing to deep point cut, blending in layers to length. We start to see the shape and what's developing in there.
So could there be a little bit of a corner there? Is that what you're looking for? Like there's something between where you actually elevated and what dropped out?
Yeah, for sure. What that corner is weight at the baseline itself. So as my layering is moving towards the actual length, what we're going to find is when that moves, you're going to end up with that little corner right there. That corner at a flush line or at 0 degrees is the stability of that baseline. So we've already taken out quite a bit of weight. We've already taken out the length and mastered where the length's going to live on her body. But within that, how much of that corner did we still leave? So here I'm just taking a little bit out. What I didn't love was the straight line that was developing. And I'll show you one more time so I can get a better section. I didn't love that this all looked like it was happening here and then all of a sudden it jumped out. So I'm going to come in here and elevate my section just a little bit higher and see all that weight that's right up and through here. I'm going to come in and we're going to slice from the inside out again. Really displacing even that much more weight in there. So when this files back in, I'll show you in just a second again. Hopefully we're going to see a little bit more of a line that floats all the way through. So let's drop this back down again. There we go. And so see how that edge is starting to feather out. A little bit of that kick right in there, but that's necessary. That's right at the back of the recession, behind the back of the ear. And if you've ever cut hair before, you have cut that section too short before. So better safe than sorry. Kind of like with the overdirection.
Gets a little bit holy.
What's that?
It gets a little bit holy.
Oh, it can. I've done it too many times, sadly.
So everybody loves the idea of the screenshot. So that's awesome.
Yeah.
Rizzy Green, I'm so excited to try this technique. Thank you for some new inspiration. And she's watching from the UK. So guys, let us know where you're watching from. We're in Northern San Diego here with Travis Parker and his academy and his private atelier here, which is just such a beautiful space. I can't wait to pick his brain about furniture here. But we're focused on haircutting now, and Travis is showing us this kind of mid-length layered shag technique using freehand pointing and slicing, but in a very deliberate way. I think sometimes people think that dry cutting is just purely visual, where you've got a lot of technique going on here, don't you?
Yeah, absolutely. We're continuing to use the contours of the head to understand what our elevation is, to understand what our distribution is, and where the layers will live. And basically, aside from that, everything else is just our technical approach to creating that fabricated line. And in this case, we're doing both, from the inside out and the outside in. I can see a massive cluster of hair right up and through the front here. There's a whole extra overhang right there. And again, just coming in. I'm going to clean that up for you, Gerard, so you got a better shot.
So I want you to talk about a couple things. First of all, the length of your comb. I notice you work with a longer comb. What, is that something you use all the time, or do you feel it's specific for this type of technique you're working with?
Well, first of all, I've got to give props to Crux. It's the clips that I use, and it's the comb that I use. The length of the comb is just a familiar length of comb that I've had, gosh, probably...
It's an 8.5-inch. 8.5-inch comb.
Yeah, last 20 years. But what I like about it is it's stiff, yet it has flexibility to it. So right now we're building convex layers. Here's concave layers. But again, the length of the comb just allows me to really move around the head, see where I'm at, and if anything, it's just comfortable in my hand for flipping it back and forth. The wide teeth are at a perfect distance for me for creating lines and sections,
And the fine teeth are at a perfect distance for me for refining that section and finding tension.
Yeah, so it's kind of a medium fine cone, which is great. We have those available on Hairbrain Pro as well. And shout out to Drew Schaefering for developing that Crooks line. Drew is a big part of the Hairbrain family. He's been on many Facebook Lives, and he's actually got a paid online class at hairbrain.pro. So obviously we do these free for all Facebook Lives. But if you want to go a little bit deeper with great camera work, we got up to 5 cameras and incredible lighting and all that amazing stuff. Check out hairbrained.me. It's actually hblive.me. Sorry, guys. hblive.me. And you can see we've got great, great courses there. They're affordable. You can have an incredible academy experience in your own home. Now, I know you're working on something currently kind of similar, aren't you? You've got a whole bunch of digital education coming out. Tell us about that.
Oh, my God. I forgot all about it. And yet it's the biggest part of my entire life right now. We are working with a company called Liberation Media from LA that's filming our methodology. And we are trying to do things in a way that's really different than how we've received information before. We're breaking all of our videos down based on the 3 pillars of the curriculum. I'm going to turn this way. We're breaking the curriculum down so it's all modular based. So you can take elements of it from the length of this haircut, layers from another haircut, and assemble it in the way that you want to build your vision. So it's interactive in that sense. It's also going to be interactive in the sense that we are allowing a online experience that's hands-on. So as you take the different tutorials, you will submit back to us results from you taking the tutorial and working on the mannequin. And when you submit that back to us, we take a look at it, and where we feel that you could improve, we make notes, we send those notes back to you. And upon those notes, you resubmit. When we feel that you have learned what we feel that you should learn from that exercise, that unlocks the next haircut and allows you to continue your process of developing. Right now, we're doing a twist and cut technique.
Yep, Jeremy Taylor is wondering what kind of fringe you're building.
Oh, we're doing a little bit of a curtain fringe right now, Mr. J. I think you actually taught this last weekend.
So I see you took a triangle section at the top. So tell us about that, and then talk about how we're actually cutting this line in.
Yeah, totally. So I've taken a triangle at the top. The arch of the brow indicates where the width of this triangle is. And then the depth of that triangle is a basic measurement of just symmetry. So finding equal length in all sides. From the center of that section, so apex of the head, which gave me about a half an inch to 3/4 inch in the width of the section, those are my shortest pieces, and I wanted to have that hit a plateau. As I'm moving to the sides now, I'm just slightly over-directing this back towards the center and continuing a twist cut technique through that edge there, which respectfully is obtaining length, so I've got a graduation that's happening from short to long.
And again, this is kind of lovingly known as the curtain these days, right? Shorter in the center.
Yeah, who actually thought of the curtain name? I don't know where that came from, but it certainly has become the name.
I mean, I think years ago we used to say it's like an A-frame versus a V-frame. I mean, there's so many different languages, but curtain is a good descriptor.
That's a great descriptor. Okay, so just continuing to see and make sure that things are navigating correctly. What I am looking for is a build of length through this line. I feel like I've got a little bit of weight on the top, so I'm going to take this, resplit it down the profile, and parallel to this diagonal line, I'm going to bring the hair over to the side, and I'm going to come across the surface and just slightly excavate a little bit more weight from it, trying not to remove the length at all, so respectfully keeping the length. And yeah, that's better. That just takes a little bit more weight out of it. I'm going to come over here and do exactly the same thing on the opposite side. Parallel to my diagonal line. Oh, this side's even heavier, so I'm gonna get a little bit more accomplished over here than I did on the previous. And
there's a suitability question from Nicole Braden Baza. I'm hoping the J is hidden in your name, Nicole. Sorry if I'm slaughtering it. What do you think about a fringe like this with someone with a very small forehead or a widow's peak?
I love it. I mean, we're all going to have our answers on how to approach this as well. If you've got a small forehead or smaller forehead that you're working with, the objective is to try to create it so that it looks like it's symmetrically normal. When we break the face down in lengths, we're looking for a third distance between the forehead and the temple region to the jawline, and jawline to chin. And so with that, a smaller forehead, that top third portion of the total length of the face is off. So what we would like to do is go more towards the apex at the top of the head and take a fringe deeper back. Make sure that your fringe is so opaque and thick right here that you cannot see where the hairline starts and stops, because then there's no read on a person having a small forehead. It's exactly the same with a thicker forehead, or with a thicker forehead, a bigger forehead. It's
five
just
head.
Bring that line, thick, big, whatever it might be. You just bring that line closer to the hairline, but the objective is that you can't see the hairline, so you don't know where the forehead actually is. I am creating a
great tips there.
Back.
Thank you for that.
I think that helped a lot. All right. So we are moving into our final bits here. I have taken a diagonal back line from the back portion of my first triangle. Diagonal back came to the back of the ear. The back of the ear is what separates what hangs in front of the shoulder as to what hangs in the back of the shoulder, which is why I've taken this line. I'm going to come to the opposite side of the section that I'm actually cutting and combing the hair teed apart. So just like we did before, to the diagonal line, I'm going to go teed apart. I'm going to come up and through the front here, and when I do it, I'm going to be real loose with my fringe, keeping it at 0 degrees, so it's a little bit heavier right now, so right up against the face. If it's too heavy, then what I will do is start to elevate this section out. The more I elevate it out, the more it starts to cut these surface layers shorter. So right now, I'm going to start down closer to the face. I've got a little bit more weight. See where the haircut falls from there. I'm going to get this last little piece off here. And once we've, again, got everything in place, we're going to see if the weight distribution's good. I can immediately see that it's heavy right there. So I'm going to take that now and take a step over to my right-hand side. So I'm using more typical or standard forward graduation. Coming at about a 45 from the head. And I'm going to internally slice, but I'm doing C-shaped movements. So it's moving back like this. And what we can imagine is if the scissor is moving back into C-shape, when I'm moving back, the tip of the shears point to the direction that's going to be supported in the structure of the hair. So she's going to get more of a whip inside the actual haircut by the direction of our channel cutting, which we call directional channel cutting. But very intentionally, we're not just thinning the hair out, but we're thinning it out with the intent of building almost graduation inside of it that whips the hair in a specific direction.
So you can really create direction, you know, based on how you use your tool.
100%.
You move that hair around the way you want to.
Yeah. If, let's just say we had a hedge and we were trimming it with a big hedge clipper. If I cut it up at an angle, you would see an angle in it. If I cut it flush, you'd see a flush. Well, it's the same thing with our scissors. Depending upon how the scissor enters it, it's going to whip the hair forward, back, left, right, up, or down. And in this case, we want it to move back. So here we are, teed apart, the rails of the comb dictate.
Get around here and get a better angle for you. My fault.
No, my bad.
Okay, here we are.
So bridge of the comb against that line, teed apart, dictates the direction that we're combing the hair. Distribution comes right into the face. Elevation is right up against the face. Shear goes underneath. And just slightly opening and closing to move all the way through. We can start to see the build of that line. I'm going to reverse here. Just sever that edge ever so slightly there. And let's see what the weight is on this side. This side doesn't look as heavy. Okay, over here, just looking at it back and forth. So going back and forth with it, you guys, it's not a defeated sort of place. It's a place of finding symmetry and balance. So
well, it's part of what we do.
The cut section. Yeah, you're back and forth the entire time trying to navigate the planes so that they're even.
Yeah, if you ever think that you're going to get something perfect the first time, I mean, that's more of an oddity than a reality, you know? It's about finding balance and checking and refining. You know, it's almost never perfect the first time for hundreds and hundreds of reasons.
Using my forward grad again, guys, combing everything straight forward. I'm still tee to the part, which now we don't see the part anymore, but I'm still combing the hair in the same direction of it. Everything's looking pretty good, and we're starting to see that real fun sort of kick and sweep that's happening. And for the fringe there, we are going to take this here, which will be the last part of our cut, unless we have to do any detailing. And just like we did on the other side, I'm going to take that little front piece off. This is still the side that was a little bit heavier, so I want to make sure that everything's still aligned. What I love about the mannequins is, as well, as much as they are perfect mannequins, there is imperfections which allow us to relate to real hair. No one's got the same density count on both sides of their head. This side, we already directionally channel cut. I still feel like I've got a collection of hair here. I'm going to elevate this out. And based upon looking through this, here's a little bit thinner, there's a little bit thicker from there on up. I'm going to come inside and just remove some of that bulk and displace some of that length. And starting in unique places each time I do it will give the effect more of just natural hair growth patterns.
Camilla Bemka is wondering if you used any products before drawing the hair for the cut.
I didn't, but I'm glad you asked the question. I haven't used any product in her at all, except for a leave-in conditioner. So I just put that in there to act as a lubricant in the hair and make it easy to comb through so I wasn't finding knots as I was building the actual style.
And is that typically what you do when you dry cut? You like to keep the hair free of a lot of product?
Yeah, I don't want to put a lot of product in it when I'm dry cutting it because I don't want to be fighting through the product. I also like to build things off the principles of natural fall and natural texture too. So I don't want to really overwork the hair and get to a point where I don't even know what the natural texture is because I fabricated something radically different.
So, awesome. So again, just to recap for you guys at home, we're here with Travis Parker, this handsome young man. He's in his 32nd year of haircutting and being an educator. He was welcoming to bring us into his academy here, the Travis Parker Academy, which is in northern San Diego. I'm going to give you a little look around. Very beautiful space, beautiful natural light and foliage outside. Look at his wonderful art collection here. Beautiful furniture. The Hollywood Regency style, which we love. And this is where Travis works on his private clientele here in Northern San Diego. And then he's doing regular classes in his Travis Parker Academy, where someone was asking before if they want to find out about your classes, where should they go?
Yeah, thank you for asking. It's a great question. We just launched our booking site right now for the classes, literally last week. It's travisparkeracademy.timetap.com. You can book your reservations right now. We haven't officially launched the dates, which I guess we are right this very second, but with that said, we had a wait list and we've sold out the first 5 classes on a wait list for next year. So the first class available is in April of next year, and next year we are combining the tiers together as well as doing them independently. So you can take Cutting Course 1 as a 2-day class. You can take 1 and 2 together as a 4-day class next year. We're also combining the second tier and the third tier together for people that have taken 1 already. And everything does need to be taken in order because we really build you with a language first and an approach to hairdressing first. And from there, we excel you through the process. So super exciting. One of the fun things about it is truly intimate. As you've seen the space, there's only 5 people that are allowed to attend each course. So it really is us working with your heart, your soul, and your hands in a way that I've never really had the privilege of doing in larger scale environments. So a real special part of what makes this academy unique, on top of the curriculum, which we feel very confident in, is changing people and the way they approach hairdressing altogether. So,
a fantastic, fantastic space, great education. So let's talk a little bit about styling. I know you have 2 pre-done ones here that will show. Same technique here.
Yeah, same technique. This was all with a flat iron first. Everything is just waves. I tried to find inconsistencies on both sides, which made it to me cooler, a little bit more of a boho vibe. And she's my rocker chick. She's the one that's really taking the shag and pushing it. This is our sectioning pattern, and I wanted to subdivide that just so you could see it on a real head versus just the screen itself. And this is more of my glamorous version of the shag as well. So this is for the gal that, my lipstick gal that's putting lipstick on before she enters any environment. This is probably more her look.
And how was that one finished? Did you use a round brush here or?
Everything with this was with a round brush and a 1.5-inch rod. And what my intent was with the rod was just to get slight bends in it. But what I didn't want was a fabricated curl set to it. So again, still trying to keep it natural, keeping it relevant with today's trend in the shag.
Fantastic. So all built off of this lovely technique that was just so thoughtfully demonstrated. You can see there's a lot of variety there. What are you working with now? Everyone always wants to know about the product.
So this is one of my new faves. This is a brand called Virtue out of North Carolina. And this is a texture spray that they've come out with that is excellent. It's favorite product of the brand.
Smells good.
And that's a tough decision because the products are legit. So I'm going to cocktail this in and then I'm going to break it down with a little bit of a product from L'Oreal Professionnel called Mythic Oil. And this is just going to lubricate the ends. And on a mannequin, I love the way the hair just drinks this up. Makes the ends more luminescent, but yet not too high gloss of a finish, and more of that satin end result. So right here, guys, I've just started to build the actual shape into the cut here itself. Gerard's being cool enough to let me do it in front of the mirror. I've got all my hot tools next to me over here just in case I need them. So
it's nice to see another finish here, because you've got the one that you waved with the iron. You've got what was kind of blown out with a round brush and a curling iron. And now this, I just love how this is just so much more raw in a great way.
Thank you, sir. I mean, clearly intentional. We wanted to show you variations to the style so you could find that person that it works best for. And matter of fact, as an exercise for you right now, one of the things that I would think about is who you would put this on right now. So in your clientele, would Julie look great with it? Would Mary look great with it? And start to position the look with a familiar face of yours, which will help you remember the actual finishing of the style itself. So just a little brain exercise. This is a straighter version. We're seeing a lot of straighter looks in general right now. We love texture still, but we want to show variation and show the relevance based upon your interest.
A great lesson. I'm going to put this back on the tripod so I can jump in here with you. I want to thank Travis Parker for having us into this fantastic space. I want to thank our sponsors, Pivot Point, for the ongoing sponsorship of Harebrained and for creating such incredible tools for educators like us. And I want to thank you guys for joining us. Peace out. We'll see you again, I think, tomorrow. Love you. Take it easy.
Bye, guys. Thanks so much. See you next time.
Hold on.
Cheers, brother.